Hi, everyone. My name is Max Bello. I work at the Mission Blue. I'm the policy advisor, and I have the joy to work with one of the most impressive human beings I have ever met, Sylvia Earle. So it's Mission Blue and the Alliance of Sylvia Earle. And we're here today to discuss and to talk, to enjoy a conversation with some amazing, incredible ambassadors of the ocean, I would call them, because it's what they do. They represent, in a way, the ocean. They bring us joy. They bring us this beauty of this incredible ocean. We have been trying to protect, and we will continue to protect. And also, Sylvia will be with us. So I'm asking you to stay all the way long, because we're going to have Sylvia in and out there. She always have something great to say to all of this. And she herself is a good photographer. Photography is one of my passions, too, and it's something I really like to do. I'm a little bit obsessed about it, and I'm sure all of these people are very obsessed, too. So I want to introduce you with some of the with this incredible photographers. I'm going to start with Christian Vizl. He's an underwater photographer and conservationist. He's been working on black and white photography, which is it's one of my favorite, actually, and they have incredible photographies, and it's not easy. You would think that it's, you know, like, might be easy to kind of fix it in black and white. No, it is actually more difficult most of the time. So because of the contrast and the light, it's really everything there. Then Joakim Odelberg, conservation filmmaker and photojournalist, TV host, so very well-known colleague of us, great partner of Mission Blue. And then Tanya Griffin, underwater photographer, of course, shark naturalist, perfect, love sharks. It's my one of my favorite species for sure. And we have great things now that we're doing, CITES and many other things that are very interesting for sharks. So she will be talking about this. She's been contributing in the Hope Spot, the Hateras. You should, if you don't know, go into the Mission Blue webpage and find out more about the Hope Spot. It's an incredible place, very close in the East Coast of the United States, where you might not think there is incredible diversity of sharks and other species. Alex Rose, science editor of Ocean Geographic magazine. If you don't know the magazine, please know it. An incredible, great magazine. I love it. Great articles. The contributors are always amazing. Good pictures, good quality magazine. Hope Spot champion of the Bunaken Marine Park. So it's also a huge collaborator. And then Pier Nirandara, best-selling author, travel writer, film producer, and underwater photographer. These people are incredible. They're insane. They have so much to tell. And then, not the last but not the least, my good friend Amos, who's been making me happier every day with his pictures around the world. So it's great to have him, an incredible one of the world leader or you know, most well-known photographers around the world. So guys, I see that you're coming from everywhere. I see Australia, Buenos Aires, Jersey, Florida, Puerto Rico, Charlotte, Switzerland, Namibia. Oh my God, it's the whole planet is coming here. And so enjoy it, and make sure to follow these people after, because they speak through their images. So I'm going to start with Christian. Christian, a pleasure to having you here. Please.
Thank you very much, Max, for the introduction. Hello, everybody. Hello, Sylvia. It's such an honor to be here with you and to share this space and to be able to talk to your audience. You're such a hero and an inspiration for all of us. So thank you. Thank you very much. And I'm very also happy to share this opportunity with the other amazing photographers. So thank you.
So Christian, actually, I'm going to ask you, and I'm going to ask the same question too. I would like to know, to start with this, I would like to know, how do you get into this? How you fell into the water and started making these amazing photographies? I mean, what did it get you first? What was the reason that we have now enjoy your pictures?
Thank you. Yeah, it's very basic, actually, and very simple. Just remember when I was a kid, I was very fortunate that my parents, even though we were living in Mexico City, but they took us a lot to camping on the beach in Mexico, in the Mexican Pacific. And I remember sitting down in the beach and just dreaming that the water would suddenly just disappear. So I just got to walk inside the ocean and see all the animals just as they were, you know, all the sharks, the whales. I was just dreaming about that. I was in love with the ocean when I was very, very young. And then, of course, all the tales by Jacques Cousteau, all the films, and so many amazing influence. And it was very late in my life that I started diving. I became then a diving instructor, and I did that for a while. And then the last thing I did was to start doing photography. And since the beginning, you know, I kind of got a very specific intention on why I was doing the photography. And I want to read something that I prepared for this talk regarding photography. So photography is such a powerful impact medium and can be very meaningful when it helps deepen understanding and empathy, spark new positive connections, and bring energy to an issue, especially at times when the ocean is living beings and all life on the rest of the planet is at risk. It contributes to culture change, which bolsters and is reinforced by other change. Changing minds is about building awareness of an issue or shifting how it is perceived. It's about deepening understanding and connecting the dots between personal experiences and image depictions. The increasing contribution of photography to making positive change in society is exciting, but we shouldn't pretend it's uncomplicated. There are plenty of examples where our social media posts of marine animal encounters, even though they are well-intended, if done irresponsibly, can actually bring negative impacts on the animals or the local communities. A few examples here in my own country are posting images of encounters in environments where the animals are harassed, obstructed, or in other ways affected by too many careless visitors and tour operators, like the orcas in La Paz, which has become quite a fuss recently. And by the way, it's forbidden by law to jump in the water with these animals, by Mexican law. Or whale sharks in Southeast Mexico, which became also such a big thing that the numbers of daily snorkelers became so many that I just stopped going many years ago. It's very sad. Also, giving location on where to find rare animals that are lucrative in the aquarium trade. One should know that poachers use our social posts to find rare and valuable animals. They go as far as Clarion in Socorro Islands, the most remote island in Mexico, to find endemic species because they are more valuable. So the challenge is to first educate ourselves, explore the possibilities for social and environmental change, and develop skillful means to responsibly create positive impact with our images, minding that they do not exploit the animal or locals, so they can actually be of service. A vital question we should ask ourselves before sharing our images with the world, especially through social media, is how will this photo benefit the animals, the environment, and the people? And if we could expand this question to all our daily actions, the world would be a very different place. It takes that each one of us acknowledges its own responsibility of the well-being of ecosystems and all life on this planet and act accordingly. The problems we have created in this world are complex, and any solution requires the combined efforts of many different sectors working together towards the same goal. So for our images to create more significant impact and change, we must collaborate and support the work of scientists, organizations, and other people and movements that align with our values and vision. In my case, this includes vegans, animal rights movements, climate activists, filmmakers, musicians, and many others that with their daily actions are doing their part. I believe that the most impactful way for us to contribute to conservation and protection of ecosystems is to develop our love and compassion for all animals. Because if we truly love them, we want them to be happy and well, and then compassion will naturally arise giving us the strength to find all possible means for them to be protected, living their lives as they are meant to be, not as our food, our product, our resource, our pets, or entertainment, but wild and free on their own right. Even if this means for us not to travel, dive with them, or even take pictures and share them with the world just because we feel like it or have a narcissistic motive behind it. So this may all sound a little bit too complicated, but sometimes creating an impactful and positive image can be very simple. In my own experience, one of the images that really impacted me deeply was an image of a bird, a dead bird in the beach. And because of the time had passed, you can see that he died because of the plastic in their stomach. I'm sure a lot of us, the people here, have seen that picture. And that led me to so many things and so much inspiration. Just one image, no text, no nothing. So now I think you are seeing one of my images in the screen.
Yeah, and I guess that's Cabo Pulmo, Christian.
Yes, exactly. So I would like to share some experiences of my own images, no? Like, this is one of my best examples. Yes, it's about Cabo Pulmo. And Cabo Pulmo, it's a place that we should all celebrate and be very happy about, because it was created by their own local population, by their own local fishermen. They used to be fishermen. But they realized that their fishing was declining so badly, and they could see and foresee that their future was not looking very bright. So they decided some 30 years ago for themselves to stop fishing and to look for other ways to make a living. So they created a protected marine area. And then they asked for the government for help. And slowly they began to change their way of living and became tour operators. So now it's a fantastic area in the world where animals have thrived more than 400%. The biomass has come back and in an incredible ways. It's a great example for the world for conservation, and that it can also benefit the local communities. So everything came together, you know, when in certain places. So using this image of this place, it's, you know, you can use it in so many ways, because no matter how many times you share it, and no matter, the people are gonna benefit, you know, from this image, the people that will go, and the people, and also the animals, because it's completely protected and it's well regulated. So it has been used in many ways. I have here a collection of the most important books that we can all have, all Sylvia Earle's books. And I am especially proud about this one. So it made the cover of the last book from Sylvia Earle. So I think it's probably the best way, you know, to put an image on the service of conservation. So if I still have time, maybe we can go to the next picture.
And then we're gonna go to Joakim. Thank you, Christian.
Yes, so briefly, this image is from Revillagigedo, the Socorro Islands. And again, it's a protected marine area, which actually it was protected because of many, many joint effort by many people. And especially science was the key to open the door to create the biggest marine park in America, which is Revillagigedo Islands, where CBL actually came, invited by the Mexican president and announced this big triumph. And again, it's very well protected, it's very well regulated. And I love to go to Revillagigedo, especially an operator which has a boat called Kino El Guardian. And she offers free spots for scientists that go there and do this very, very important science that helps to protect this environment. So again, posting these kind of images and telling about them and telling about the place, I think it does create a great benefit. Yes.
Thank you, Christian, so much. And Mexico, I just came back from Mexico 2 weeks ago. I was there in La Paz, and we had a great meeting with our partners there, Beta Diversidad and others. And it's amazing. I mean, every time I get in the water, I was with the Marlins in the water. It's just incredible diversity. I mean, clearly Jacques Cousteau did a mistake by calling it the aquarium of the world. So thank you so much for bringing to the world this beauty and this importance of this mega diverse country too, and to help us to call the attention around the world. So this is great. Rabia Helm, Kaupunmo, probably some of the best examples of why we need to create more marine protectors and connecting them. So I'm gonna pass now to Joakim. Joakim, please, the time is yours. And tell us, how do you get here? You know, and how do you became an amazing photographer like you are?
Yeah, it's a thank you, Christian, for a nice presentation. First of all, it was when I had my first. You see, behind me is the manta rays, and it was my first encounter with the manta rays back in the 2007. I never ever been, you know, experienced that kind of big marine animal before. And she, it was a female, and she occurred like an angel from the deep blue. And she came up and she stayed with me, and I totally fell in love. And that should have been a super, you know, experience. But sadly, when we got back up in the boat, it was a guy there, opened up a beer can, knocked it back, and threw the beer can in the sea. And I reacted really strong to that. I was thinking, how the hell could you do this when we had this experience? And he changed my life then and there on the spot. I was in music. I was studying music. I was, you know, working in music. But I decided then and there to try to change people's attitude, to raise awareness. And I've been doing that since that dive. So.
But that's amazing. I love the power of the images and what is behind. No, sometimes it's so hard to express what is actually there, even when we're, you know, I do photography. I'm not anywhere close to what you guys do, but I love to take pictures, and it's just hard to sometimes represent, no, what is under the water. So yeah. Please keep going, Joakim.
Yeah, I just want to say that it was also where I understood, because I started to look at things quite differently after that beer can. I saw more destructive human impact. And, you know, with the camera as the sharpest of swords, you can actually make changes. So I want to start, but I want to swap photo. I want the other photos first, actually. Thank you so much. So, and we were talking about hope today, and I think it's extremely important to have hope. It's extremely important to have a vision, to set goals and reach those goals. We live in times where democracy is questioned, where biodiversity, ecosystem, climate, and environmental issues are not taken as seriously as they should. I think, so it's critical to spread hope, to show that we can turn negative trends into positive results, but we need to be able to back them up. And I took I got my first diving mask when I was 3 years old. And I took my first diving certificate when I was 10 years old, with a vision, with a dream, with hope that I one day would swim and dive with sharks. And now I'm doing that on quite a regular basis. And before the pandemic in December, I was invited to join an expedition to Cocos Island with world leading shark scientists, marine biologists and explorers, to document the work they do when they tag sharks. And my work was, as I said, to document that, both for my own TV series called One Planet, One Chance, and also for the people I worked with there. And the reason why they were tagging sharks at Cocos Island, this beautiful place on the planet, the richest water in the world when it comes to sharks, or one of them, was to learn the migrating route or pattern of sharks between the Cocos Island and the Galapagos. And when I realized the purpose with that they were trying to establish a marine protected area between the Cocos Island and the Galapagos, this vast, giant area. I was thought, wow, that's almost like a utopia. I wonder if that ever will happen. So, but we kept on working both underwater, and as you can see in the photo, we tried to catch shark as well next to the boat, and we put a satellite tag or a GPS on them so we could follow them. And when I come back home, got back home, this swimway became a Mission Blue hope spot, and they announced it just a little after I got back home from Cocos. And before we launched my TV series, I talked to Dr. Alex Hearn, who was head of the scientists there on that expedition. And he told me this amazing news that it's actually going to happen. And I know that the president of Ecuador at COP26, I think it was, announced that this marine protected area will actually happen. And talk about changing a negative trend to something positive, because we need more marine protected areas in the world. And I took this, you know, setting a vision or having a vision, setting a goal, reaching that goal and create this is, you know, I was really inspired by that and very, very happy to be a tiny little part of that expedition. And when I got back home, I also got European Union Citizen Initiative contacted me about the shark fin trade in Europe. What I didn't know is that Europe is one of the biggest shark fin exporters in the world to Asia. We kill about 112 to 150,000 tons of shark every year. And it's illegal on a European Union fishing vessel to actually fin sharks. But inspections at sea are very rare, so you can basically do almost whatever you want out at high seas. But they asked me to help them to raise awareness with photos and film and being in front of the camera to actually get votes. And we started with the UK, England, because UK together with Portugal, Spain and France are the biggest, you know, shark fin industries in Europe. And we needed to collect, and you use your right as a European Union citizen to vote for this matter. And we needed 500,000 votes for it to be brought up in the UK Parliament. And 500,000 votes is quite a lot of votes. But we reached that. We reached it. We had the vision. We set the goal and we reached the goal. And we managed to get over 500,000 goals, and they took it up in the UK Parliament, and they decided to stop the trade, to stop the export and import with shark fins in the UK. And of course, we are a big team working with this, and it's amazing. And now we're doing the same thing with the European Union, but they requires 1 million votes, and that's a lot of votes. And last week, I found out when we had a meeting that we reached 1.1 million votes. So now it's going up in the European Union Parliament. We can just hope that they follow the example of the UK. And that's the impact of photos and film and content and hope, if you like, in changing negative trends into something positive. It's so important. And now we can swap photo. Thank you. For a long time, I had this dream of documenting and filming the most beautiful parts in the Nordic countries, from the sand dunes in Denmark all the way up to the glaciers of Svalbard. And I wanted to try to make it a little different. So a documentary, I wanted to do something else. And I got the opportunity to meet with the Gothenburg Symphonic Orchestra, which is the Swedish National Symphonic Orchestra, about this, and they loved the idea. So now this idea became Nordic of Fragile Hope. And we invited now five different composers from five Nordic countries, and they're writing original music to what I film. And I'm going underwater, I'm going on land and in the air, but we do a statement we try not to fly a single mile. So it's a sustainable project we're doing. And for example, if I swim with orcas and they swim above me, it's going to be projected in the ceiling. We have northern light in the ceiling, glaciers and natures in on the walls. So we're going to use the whole concert hall as a projection with live music on stage. And it's all about beauty and science. And on the photo, we see a humpback whale coming up for food, and they migrate chasing the herring. And we sail from Bergen, Norway, up to Tromsø, and it's over 1,200 nautical miles in November. It took over 7 days in storms, and it was really harsh and tough, and I didn't like it at all. But when we came up to Tromsø, the sea died and got all still. And you saw the sun coming up behind, almost reaching over the mountain tops and color the sky golden yellow. And you see the white snow on the mountains and the steel blue fjord ocean where those giants of the deep lives. And they are the true ocean ambassadors. They are the real environmental heroes, those giants. And we know that. And actually, Dr. Sylvia, we talked about this, and this is so inspiring, I think. We were talking about how important whales are alive and how much carbon dioxide they absorb, or they are living carbon sinks. So during their lifetime, they take up massive amounts of tons of carbon dioxide. And when they die, they sink to the seafloor and the seabed absorb the carbon. Circle of life. But we also have the solutions right in front of our nose. We just have to be willing to see them. And these, you know, when they go down to chase the herring up to the surface, they come up and breathe, they poop, and their iron-rich feces is a perfect growing, has a perfect growing condition for the phytoplankton. And phytoplankton are microscopic creatures, but they have enormous influence on the planet's atmospheres, capturing an estimated 40% of all carbon dioxide produced on the planet. Four times the amount captured by the Amazon rainforest. And we know that if the whale population can increase, not only humpback, but whale population increase with only 1%, we can actually tackle the climate crisis and the emissions for real. We need to find the solutions. They are there. We need to see them. And this is what Nordic A Fragile Hope is all about. Taking and meeting these amazing, having these amazing encounters together with science and supporting science 100%. And show and, you know, inflict hope and inspiration to make people willing to be a part of a sustainable climate smart future. I just want to end this and say that hope is not blind faith. Hope is about, and we need hope. We need to hope for a better future, a more healthy, just, sustainable future. But hope is about having a vision. And to reach that vision or goal, it requires action. So if each and every one of us takes action in what we do towards a more sustainable, healthy future, all us in the panel, all the people watching now, your sisters and brothers, mothers and fathers, children, if we take action in what we do, my ocean sisters and brothers, there is hope. Thank you.
Thank you, Joakim, for those really inspirational words and your stories. Really, really great to having you here and to continue seeing your work is amazing. Thank you for bringing that up. The Migramar people, you know, they're working there in the corridor, my colleagues too, and amazing work that they are doing in science. Sharks need our help. There's a COP of CITES now coming in the next couple weeks. I mean, actually in 1 week. And it's gonna decide the future of the exports of 54 species of sharks, the Rekians, which are among the most traded species on Earth. And we're hoping countries will vote to list them, because we need to stop that madness.
Yes,
sharks are disappearing and they're extremely important. So thank you for that. Europe, it's very important. Spain is one of the biggest exporters of fins on Earth. People normally tend to blame only, Asian countries, and that's not true. We all have our part, and we all have our part, as you said it, on making things right. So thank you so much.
Thank you for
your time and for your great words. I want to continue now with Tanya. Tanya Griffin, if you can tell us how you got into this world, underwater world, and this image immediately, it's like insanity. And it's right here. I'm in Maryland, so I'm very close to it in a way,
Then come dive, come dive with the sand tiger sharks then.
I'll be there tomorrow.
If I were going, I'd take you along. I'll be down there in a few more weeks. But yeah, it was these sharks, though, very what you're looking at, the sand tiger sharks that convinced me to pick up a camera. I started diving North Carolina as a newer diver around the 2009 timeframe, and immediately fell in love with these sharks. And my first impression was that, wow, everything I've seen in the media is completely wrong about these animals. And I just became fascinated by them. And so I started just learning as much as I could about sharks, and quickly found out about shark finning and just how horrible the plight is for so many shark species. And I wanted to do something. And at this point, I had no idea photography was going to be on the horizon. I just started to get involved with shark conservation. I ran a marathon to raise $1,000 for Shark Savers. And then I thought, well, maybe I'll start learning about photography, because I had no photography background. But I thought, well, maybe I got to start somewhere. And my hope was that maybe within a few years, I would take some decent pictures and that the public might be a little bit inspired by those and see sharks the way that I saw them, as these beautiful, graceful, intelligent animals that desperately needed our help. And everything happened a lot more quickly than I thought, though. The photography really took off. And by the next year, I quit my job as a mathematician in the corporate world and literally walked into work one day and handed my bosses my badges and my laptop and told them I don't work there anymore. I was going to go hang out with sharks. And I'm sure they thought I was crazy, but I've done all right. So yeah, it was these sharks. It was diving with the sand tigers that did that. And that's why I was so happy that that the Hatteras Hope Spot came into existence a few years back. The waters off of North Carolina are there's this incredibly unique, vibrant ecosystem that we do need to pay attention to and that we do need to try to protect as best we can. So, going back to the whole theme of this with, how do we use these photos for conservation? Well, first of all, somebody looks at this and they think, wow, somebody was in the water with these animals. And I think right then and there, that piques the interest, because you've got to pique interest. And it starts with a compelling image. And that's the goal that we're all trying to do, is this compelling image to pull the viewer in and try to learn more about what it is that we are trying to portray through these images. Another big theme of mine is dispelling misconceptions about sharks. You always think of the shark as, or at least a lot of the public does, as that the lone predator out there hunting, and they can be incredibly social, as you see here. We get these massive aggregations of sand tigers off of North Carolina all around the year. First, we thought they were mainly just in the summer, but we're actually seeing them at various times of year. And what we do notice about these summer aggregations, and I took this photo in the month of July back in 2015, once I started to look at these, I thought, wow, that's a lot of girl sharks. And you can tell the difference between a male and a female. The females are kind of flat on the underside. Males have appendages called claspers that kind of hang down. They use them for mating. And so depending on the age of the shark, sometimes it's hard to tell if the shark is a younger male. But we started to notice these big female aggregations, and that really hadn't been seen before or hadn't been noticed. So in that way, photography really helped to kind of shift that paradigm of what we thought about these animals. And that in turn kind of parlayed into a program that I helped to develop with the North Carolina Aquariums called Spot a Shark USA, where we actually use photos of sand tiger sharks that any diver can take, upload to the Spot a Shark USA website. And then we can go in and identify the individual sharks based on their spot patterns, which are unique, just like a fingerprint in humans. And we have, I think, around 2,000 sharks in the database right now. It's been going on since around 2016, 2017. We're learning so much about these animals. So, you know, the research ultimately is going back into conservation. Conservation has always been the goal of mine with my images. And I'm also now very much involved in shark research. And so I think that we, you know, of course we as photographers want to take beautiful, compelling images. But another great thing about images is we can get so much information out of them, like we did with learning about these female aggregations. And that these sharks are quite a bit more social than we ever thought. So I think that this photo grabs the public's attention, hopefully makes them want to learn more about these animals. And as you can see, these sharks are just kind of swimming along, doing their thing. It's not a massive feeding frenzy. It's, you know, another misconception people have. Sharks are always eating. I have been around thousands of sand tiger sharks in my life. I have not seen one take a bite yet. So, you know, that's another thing, the whole dispelling misconceptions thing. Also, this photo was actually taken above a shipwreck. We have a lot of shipwrecks off of North Carolina, which act as artificial reefs. An entire like micro ecosystems develop around these shipwrecks. And so these sharks were actually hanging out probably about 30 to 40 feet above a shipwreck. So, you know, part of the research I'm doing is trying to figure out why these sharks are attracted to the wrecks and what exactly they're doing out there. Now, in one more way that we also use science with the photographs is that a lot of times I will take lasers down. I have, it's called paired laser photogrammetry, and the lasers are attached to the side of my camera housing. And the way that it works is that each laser emits a green light. So when I take a photo of a sand tiger shark, you'll see two green dots when I'm doing this. So what that means is that we can actually get an accurate measurement of that shark just from a photograph, because we know the distance apart of the lasers and we know the width of the photograph. And then using math, yay, math, remember I was a mathematician, we can then calculate the length of that shark without ever touching it. So there are so many ways that photography can help research, help conservation, change public perceptions. And then speaking of grabbing the public's attention, if you'll go to the next photo, please. This one certainly captured the public's attention, and I am so, so grateful for that. And a lot of people have asked me, you know, what did you think when you took that? To be honest, I thought as I was going through the photos that I had taken that day, I thought, yeah, this one's all right. I won't delete this one. And it really captured the public's imagination. And I'm very thankful for that. One of the things, though, that people always seem to think is that the shark is going through and eating those little fish, those mackerel scab. And it wasn't. And this is a really good teachable moment for people who want to learn more and, you know, dive more in depth into these images, a little bit of a pun intended there. This is a perfect example of that mutual symbiotic relationship that we all learned about in high school biology. That shark really isn't interested in eating those tiny little mackerel scat. It wants a little bit bigger prey, such as small rays or snappers, lobsters, things like that. So what happens is, those fish hang around the shark because the things that will eat those little fish won't come near that shark. It's kind of like having a bodyguard. And so they also get the little scraps of food that are left over when the shark eats. What does the shark get out of it? Well, those bait balls, as we call them, can encircle a shark so thickly that you barely even know that a shark is there. There have been times that I've only been a foot or two away from a sand tiger, had no idea at first because the bait ball was so thick around it. That gives the shark the element of surprise. It can then kind of dart out from that bait ball, eat what it does want to eat, and you know that kind of then go back to being camouflaged. So again, this is dispelling that misconception that sharks eat everything in sight. That is absolutely not the case. And these beautiful, amazing symbiotic relationships between animals in the water that have been formed over thousands and millions of years. And off of North Carolina, we see things like this all the time. We see the incredible diversity, the sharks, turtles, barracuda, dolphins, eels, and other shark species, not just the sand tigers, that are out there all the time. And that's why I am so grateful that the waters off of North Carolina have been named a hope spot. And I'm grateful to Dr. Earle, a big hero of mine, and Mission Blue for continuing that work to name hope spots all around the world to hopefully bring attention to them, just like we're trying to do to the waters off of North Carolina.
Thank you so much, Tanya. Those pictures are insane. I mean, it's just, I want to be there. So, I mean, it seems so easy, but it's so complicated to get a shot like that. I mean, it requires a lot of time.
Yeah, I was actually on my back. So she kind of swam up above me and I just went on my back and held my breath so the bubbles wouldn't go up and startle her. I didn't want to startle her because she was only about 2 to 3 feet above me. And just hoping my settings were right. I think it's every underwater photographer has them. Oh, just please let the strobe settings and everything be right. So just one of those days when it all came together. And thank you to everybody who enjoys that image.
No, thank you. And, you know, you mentioned a couple of things. You know, we see the ocean also, and it seems like the same always, every day. It's just, you know, because we see it from above. But then we think about this three-dimensional, amazing structure in this planet that has been providing, you know, the blue of this sky comes from life in the ocean. You know, people sometimes don't realize how oceans are so important. What is happening under the water also need to, you know, it's worrisome. I mean, like there's so many things that are wrong right now. But at the same time, we have people like you, we have people like Joakim, Christian, Amos, everyone, you guys doing such a great job on bringing those images so we can see what is under there. We see what is happening too. And, you know, in Chile, I'm Chilean, it's the 10th biggest economic exclusive zone on Earth. When we start working with sharks, people didn't know that there are, you know, more than 50 species counted that have been seen in the waters of Chile. You would think, you know, like sharks are only like the hot place, tropical, you know, and now they're everywhere and they should be everywhere and get worried if they're not. So thank you.
Thank you. I think it's for so many people, it's out of sight, out of mind. And what we as photographers do is bring that to the front of people's mind. So you're right. People don't realize all of this is going on every day around the world under the water. And I think that's part of what our big job is to bring that to the forefront of the public perception.
And that's what Sylvia wants. Sylvia wants like a fleet of submarines. She's probably going to tell us about that because people need to see it. I really enjoy what is going on the chat because there's a lot of connection. Guys, you're doing great. Please connect each other. That's what we need because no one can do everything, but everyone can do something. And really it's important to work all together. So connect yourself, connect with us, connect with everyone. And we can do a better job on saving the ocean. I'm gonna leave you now with Alex. Alex Rose, please, Alex, the stage is yours.
Very good. Now I'm gonna have you start with the other picture, please. So hi, thanks for Thanks for having me. I'm assuming we want to start with the same question, which is how I got into this. I'm landlocked. I'm from Chicago. So I didn't grow up around an ocean, but I did have a lake, which is a good start. Actually, a lot of where my love from fish comes from is that as a Chicagoan, we've got Shedd Aquarium, which is one of the coolest aquariums out there. And I spent countless hours staring at fish as a child. And that really solidified my interest in them as an adult. I've been scuba certified for about 13 years now. And it really wasn't until then that I got serious about photography. And once I got underwater, it became really apparent that it would be silly for me not to share the view as much as possible. And once you start looking at your own images, you see so many ways for them to get better. But underwater photography is rather expensive, as I'm sure most people have learned who are interested in it. And I was really lucky to be connected with a very cool group called the Women Divers Hall of Fame. And they have a series of wonderful scholarships and grants. And I applied for one of their dive training grants and got it and was able to get my dive master certification as well as buy some of my first underwater camera gear, which without the help of that grant probably wouldn't have been possible because it's very cost restrictive. So that's kind of how I got into it. And then I started writing articles for Ocean Geographic magazine about 8 years ago. And as soon as I started writing, I really got obsessed with having my own images to use for my stories. And that's really how I got seriously into underwater photography. And the rest is history, as they say.
Amazing. I love that story, Alex. This is great. Keep going, please. Tell us
all
more.
Right. So I've got two images to show you today. Of course, we all have a bazillion of them, so choosing two is really hard. But I'm actually going to start a timer for myself so that I don't go over time. Anyway, so this first one is, of course, of a sea lion, and it's probably a familiar location by now. A lot of people photograph sea lions here. This is from Los Islotes in La Paz. So Sea of Cortez, actually the Gulf of California in general, is a hope spot, which is fantastic. But if you go a little bit farther up, I think it was initially established because of the extremely endangered nature of the vaquita. But we don't really see them, of course, when we go diving. But what you do see are sea lions. So if you stay in La Paz, you can go about an hour and a half to a lovely island chain called Espiritu Santo. And the most northern one is Los Islotes, which is a sea lion rookery, which is home to between 200 and 400 sea lions every year. Most of the time when we go, the most fun animals to photograph are the young ones because they're really curious and they want to play with you. And it's a great interaction. My friend Luke, who lives there, describes it as like diving into a bathtub full of Labrador puppies. And that is the most accurate description, I think, of diving with young sea lions that I've heard. They're great. And of course, they're the most photographed. Now, when I went there, really wanted to, after a few years, photograph them in a little bit different way because we always see the pups, which is fun. But I try to always bring a new perspective to these places that we keep seeing. And some years, especially when you go there in October, there are so many fish around Los Islotes. And this was one of those years. This was back in, I think, 2018. And there were just so many sardines, which was wonderful. But getting an image of fish moving really quickly with sea lions around them can be a bit tough. And I really wanted an image of one of the older ones, not one of the pups playing, but one of the older ones kind of getting into the habit of learning how to hunt for fish. So this image sort of speaks to the importance of just quietly sitting and watching things underwater. And if you've got the time, which is really a gift that scuba gives us, is this gift of time underwater, is to sit and watch and go back to the same dive site. I've been to this side of the island, gosh, I don't know, probably 100 times at this point. And it's the reason that I'm able to get images like this, because you sit and you watch and you look at it at different seasons. It's this whole site fidelity concept where you see what happens with different animals at different times of year. So this particular sea lion, I noticed, spent a lot of time making figure eights around these two rocks, and she'd always burst through the sardines in the same place. And I thought, okay, if I position myself in the right place, I should be able to get her coming through the fish. And also when you watch the fish schooling, I always noticed that they would break right. Now, when you're photographing underwater, especially with strobes, you'll know that it's really easy to blow out or overexpose fish, especially shiny ones, because they're so reflective and it wrecks your image. So if you notice that there are going to be more fish on one side, you can turn your strobe down on one side. So I turned my right strobe way down, my left strobe way up, and just kind of waited for the moment. And it happened. And I was so, so happy. And I think she was, this sea lion looks a bit surprised that I was there. Not startled, because they're very used to divers at Los Islotes, but surprised, because you wouldn't necessarily expect to see a diver right in your swimming path, which is why I kind of tried to hide myself behind a rock so that she wasn't scared or anything. But putting a lot of thought into these images, I think, is really what makes them so fun to create, but also really challenging. This is a great place to go every time of year, other than the 3 months in the summer when it's closed for the breeding season. But I would so, so highly recommend going to check out this place. Of course, this sort of brings up the concept of, can you love a place to death? And yeah, and it's happened a lot of places. And is there so much such a thing as too much interaction? Probably. I don't know what that limit is, but I'm sure there is one if we were able to ask the sea lions. The good thing is it is pretty heavily regulated, and you do have to go through certified tour operators, because it is part of a marine park. So you get a little bracelet, you pay a park fee, and you get to spend time with these animals. So you always want to make sure, and this goes for anywhere, that you're interacting with the animals and participating in tourism in the right way, because there definitely is a right and wrong way to participate in tourism. And there's a lot of greenwashing that happens around the concept of ecotourism. And we have to be wary of that, especially as image makers and people who put these images out into the world with stories attached to them. It's so critical that we craft a narrative that's helpful for the animals and the people who are local to the region, so that they're making money, but not in a way that endangers the wildlife in perpetuity. So this is kind of one of those images that I like to talk about, because it lets us kind of address a bunch of different concepts. Plus, it's a sea lion. You really can't go wrong. They're just great. So that's that one. And let's pop over to the next one. So the pandemic has changed a lot of things for a lot of people. And for me, it put me underwater in freshwater areas a lot more than saltwater. Until 3 years ago, I was kind of exclusively ocean going as far as photography goes. And since the pandemic, I started exploring a little bit closer to home. This image is from the Northern California coast in a really cool little river system called the Chetco. And I've become more than mildly obsessed with this place in the last year and a half. And it's just so unique. And it's not one of those places that people go to photograph things underwater. And I saw this scene. So I'd been back to the same spot on the Chetco maybe 5 times. And it looks different every time of year. And suddenly I got there in the summer and it was just full of this beautiful green algae. And I thought, well, it's never looked like this before. I wonder what's going on in here. And initially I just kind of went onto this level to go photograph this scene because of the algae. And then I realized that the other thing that I'm wildly obsessed with, which are the newts on the West Coast, also were hanging out in this region. And I thought, oh man, I bet if I wait long enough, a newt will come through my photo. So I waited and waited, and the sun started to go down, and I was like, oh no, it's not going to happen. And then one newt out of the nice cold, chilly bottom of this little section of the river kind of crept up along this algae. And I think it just looks like a castle. It looks like this big algae castle, and just positioned itself nicely. And this, I only have 3 shots of this, and then it wandered off. So much of underwater photography and just photography in general, I think, is being prepared and being prepared to wait. You have to be patient, and you're not going to get natural photos and natural interactions with animals if you push them. You just have to let them happen and be content with the fact that sometimes it's just not in the cards. You might wait all day to get a photograph, the right photograph at the right time of day, and it just doesn't happen. And that's okay. You can always try again. And there are plenty of opportunities to go back and try for more. So I love this one. I always call it Newt Nebula, because it reminds me of one of those images from NASA of one of the crazy nebulas in interstellar space. But this one's made of algae and has a newt in it. So this is sort of a fun microcosm type picture that mimics a world that's very, very far removed from ours, but that is in tandem much smaller. So yeah, I like to be able to create both saltwater and freshwater images that kind of give us a new perspective. And to me, this is what being an explorer is all about. So I'm a fellow of the Explorers Club, and I'm actually talking there this weekend, which I can't wait for. And I love to tell stories about seeing things from a new perspective. It's very tempting as someone who calls themselves an explorer to try to go to these really far-flung locations and say, well, no one's ever been here, so I'm going to go there. And that's great. And people need to do that. Exploration of unknown places is fantastic. But exploration to me is a lot more of a mindset than it is a place. You don't have to travel around the world and to the opposite side of the globe to find adventure or to explore something new. It's much more about how we choose to see things and how we look at the world around us. And being an explorer is, to me, much more about that. And by photographing scenes like this that are only a couple feet underwater, that may be completely ignored, is something that any of us can do anywhere. You might wind up with a puddle of water in your backyard that's got frogs in it. And I'd encourage you to go shoot that, because it's what you see and it's what's by you. And it's important to share that exploration type perspective with as many people as we can, and encourage them to do the same. Because at this point, most people have smartphones. And that's a great thing, because it means all of these fantastic images and viewpoints from all over the world are now available at our fingertips. And we can all share these things and try to put this collective story together about what it means to be human and what it means to be part of this wonderful blue planet that we are very lucky to call home. So those are my images.
Amazing, Alex. I love your enthusiasm. I mean, it's really great to hear you and all the stories. And I love also how you portrayed, you know, that we sometimes we have these things right here, right there. It's the nature around you. I remember when I wanted to be at a certain point when I was young. That was a long time ago. And so I asked a photographer, what should I do? Like, I want to be a photographer. And so, like, you know, you have a backyard. I mean, like, your backyard in my case was Patagonia. It's like, how many people wanted to be there, you know?
Yeah.
Like, do that. And I really, sometimes I go even deeper into this, you know, do your real backyard, like how many things you can find there.
Yeah, absolutely. There's always something to see. And it's one of my favorite things to talk about, especially when I do presentations for kids, is I think, especially when you talk about being a photographer, they think, oh, well, you have to have a big fancy camera and I can't have that. And it's like, it's a mindset. Like, what you choose to show in an image is something that you can do by doing this. I mean, this is the back of your camera. Anyone can hold up their fingers and make a viewfinder. And it's storytelling. I mean, you can practice that whether you have a phone or a camera or not. It's just choosing what view you're going to show and what part of your narrative you want to share with the world. So anyone anywhere can do that.
No, amazing. And you touched into another thing also that I really, you know, I think is important. There are many people with cameras now, and they can do great things. But also, I mean, it's important that we need to understand, because we see those images sometimes in Instagram and it's like, I want to get that picture too. And I want to jump into where I want to. And there, you know, we also need to be mindful, respectful of wildlife.
Yes.
For our safety too, but mainly for their space. I mean, nobody wants, you know, a camera in their face. Of course, none of us. And I think it's important that we also understand you guys are also professionals. And I've seen some of you, I've seen other friends, you know, doing their jobs. It's really impressive. It takes a long time. It takes a lot of effort. It's not the camera. It's really the ethics, it's really the professionalism. I mean, there are many things there. So we need to remember that it's important. But it's key also at the same time that we get these images because people can understand, they can put a face. I mean, like Sylvia always talks about the personality of fish. I mean, I've seen it. Yeah. I've been there, like, in places, you know, where like they recognize the fish, a fish that will dive all that with you. And it's like, you know, he lives there, he likes divers. I mean, each of them have a personality. Each of them are important, like all of us. So anyway, thank you so much for your for speaking here with us today.
Thank you.
I'm gonna go now with Pier Nirandara. Pier, tell us also how do you get into this beautiful underwater world. We're very excited to hear you. Please go ahead.
So Thank you so much. So my name is Pier Nirandara, and I'm an author, a film producer, an underwater photographer, an expedition leader. But my diving journey actually started with writing children's books about mermaids. So I was born and raised in Bangkok, Thailand, and felt the need to do real life research. So I got myself diving certified and completely fell utterly in love with it. I was going to talk about, you know, the photo of the mobile arrays of the humpbacks, but I'm actually signing in right now from Cape Town, South Africa. So I figured I would talk about two photographs from that country that so changed my life and my relationship to the water. So the first is this shot from the Sardine Run. It was taken far from the urban sprawls of Cape Town and Johannesburg and a part of the country that actually very few people venture to. And it's where you can wake up to the blazing sunrise over the ocean. You can surf your soul away. And you can also witness what happens to be the greatest underwater migration on Earth. So this place is known as the Wild Coast. And at the age of 24, I was working an office job in Los Angeles in the film industry when I booked a diving trip there. And it was to photograph this phenomenon known as the Sardine Run. So despite its misnomer, the Sardine Run has actually nothing to do with running marathons. It's nicknamed the Blue Serengeti. And it's this event that occurs that's larger in number than the wildebeest migration of Eastern Africa. It's where millions of fish migrate up the coast. They huddle into these tight, tight bait balls as a form of protection. And the shoals can oftentimes stretch out to kilometers long. It's pretty crazy stuff. And I have a very distinctive memory of taking this photo where, you know, I spent this very long week essentially on a bit like a rubber dinghy, riding up and down the coast, searching for these bait balls of sardines. You know, you're getting blasted by salt water. It's really cold because it's a South African winter. And then finally the guides spot the swarm of gannets, which are these birds that are diving from on top. So the birds signal the elusive bait ball, and we scrambled to put on all our gear. We're super stiff, we're cold, we're shivering to the bones. And we essentially jump in to an ocean full of sharks that are hunting these bait balls. So at the mercy of the currents, you're witnessing common dolphins blowing bubbles to herd the sardines and these tight bait balls. Gannets, the birds are raining down from the sky, and the thudding sounds that they make actually draw up the sharks from the depths. And that's when I took this photograph of, you know, a shark chomping down on a huge bait ball, and every single bite sends an explosion of glittering scales out of its gills, which were just insane to me. It was, you know, utterly magnificent, and definitely one of the most crazy encounters I've had in just the privilege of photographing. And I remember like my life flashing before my eyes. I felt super, super small, like a speck in this massive glittering universe, because the ocean is glittering with fish scales. And during that trip, I realized that, you know, life is hard for two reasons, either because you're leaving your comfort zone or actually because you're staying in it. And in scuba diving, any of you guys who are divers know that we have this act called the giant stride. And it's where, you know, you step at the edge of the boat, you put on your gear, and you do this large step into the unknown. So this trip taught me to embrace the giant stride into the unknown as a life philosophy. And it really jump-started my entire career in diving for social good and the importance of awe and of personal experiences and catalyzing action. Like, it's one thing to see an image kind of from a distance, another to encounter it for real in the water. You have all the sensations, your heart is pounding out of your chest, and coming out of a situation like that, it's very, very difficult to not care about the plight of, you know, the oceans, the animals, and their well-being after having encountered it for yourself. So this image for me holds a very, very important kind of just like memory for the trajectory of my entire life and how the importance of awe and of hope in underwater photography. If we could go to the next photo, please. So after the Sardine Run, I made multiple visits back to South Africa. And this photograph is actually of my friend Shamir at a wreck known as the Antipolis in Cape Town. So Shamir is a conservationist and an underwater filmmaker. And he's actually best known for a short film, which chronicles his journey from the Cape Flats, which is an area in Cape Town with a very complex history of displacement during apartheid. And he essentially discovered free diving after that. I actually believe that it won the Sylvia Earle Ocean Conservation Award at an international film festival. So for a person of color, diving into a shipwreck represents so much more than just outward exploration. You know, oftentimes we see on social media, there's like this tiny human and this big landscape, and it's kind of like, it's in a way, it's a very like narcissistic view of looking at a landscape. It's just like your own platform for self-discovery. But for a lot of people, like it's, especially people of color, diving in a shipwreck, it's not just an outward exploration, but also an inward exploration of the self and of personal history. So for some, wrecks can trigger memories of their ancestors who actually arrived in the Cape hundreds of years ago as slaves, countless drowned in shipwrecks. And so diving a shipwreck can be both tragic and cathartic. And my time in South Africa really helped me understand that photography has more of a role than just taking pretty wildlife images, which is amazing on its own. And photographing animals is magnificent and it'll never get old for me. But there's also this massive human element in our relationship to the water and in our representation of, you know, marine spaces and who gets to tell those stories, who gets to be in those pictures. And if we're to break down these, you know what, we call like the walls of apathy of how do we get people to care about marine conservation and about the ocean? It all begins with everyone feeling like they actually belong in the sea. And I think that to me, like, it completely changed my view of diving and of photography and of its role of, instead of just taking these beautiful images, what can it actually catalyze? What can it do? What can it lead to? And I think the beautiful thing about this particular image too is that Shamir, who it depicts, actually now ends up working with, he works in introducing kids from underprivileged communities like the Cape Flats into the water to discover it for themselves, to hopefully catalyze their reactions. And he actually works in an area in False Bay, which Mission Blue declared as a hope spot, because in his words, he says that the children are our hope. And I think that's just a really, really beautiful message to show the power of photography, the power of representation, and kind of that beautiful interconnectedness between what we have with wildlife and how important it is, you know, that social media can be used for good, that photography can be used for good, and our responsibility to cherish and to nourish the planet that we live on.
Thank you so much, Pier. This is amazing source, and I love, you know, South Africa is such an important place. We know a lot about, you know, the great whites and some of the things, but now we realize more. And thanks to the movie, my octopus t-shirt too, we knew more about the some of other things, like for example the kelp forest. Again, in my country, actually we have kelp forest that is amazing, and now we know it's just not just, you know, capturing a lot of carbon, which is great for us because it would help us to come out of this crisis if we stop, you know, emissions, if we also save nature. But it's more important because it's, you know, a place with so much diversity, and I'm sure you have seen most of that. And I would love to, I was looking at your pictures also in Instagram, people, if you can follow her and follow all of these people that are here, amazing photography that you have. And I like also that you're using no blue, no green for your Instagram. That's awesome.
I think that it's just like really, really important to also, like, I love big animals. I mean, my backdrop is of the humpback whales in French Polynesia, so don't get me wrong at all. But I think to see, like, you know, what is our responsibility as humans interacting with these animals? We talk about this a lot, about, you know, blowing up a spot, and how does you know, we talked earlier on in this event about places in the Yucatan or in Mexico or around the world. And I've seen it in my home country in Thailand, where diving and over tourism has completely decimated an environment, you know? So where is that fine line that we draw between wanting to have these places be accessible for the public and not have it be just like this prestigious club where very few people can access it, but at the same time managing the conservation elements of said place and, you know, representation within that area as well. And I think, you know, South Africa is just such an important place for that, given its history and given its diversity in both the human and the ocean element.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we always like connect Africa with the land diversity, you know, which is impressive and beautiful and everything. But knowing this, you know, the underwater world And I think, you know, it makes it even, you know, huge, bigger compared. So no, appreciate that what you're doing, and thank you so much for being today with us.
Yeah, the joke is that, you know, once you start diving, the world doubles in the places you have to go and explore.
Yeah, and if you take a submarine, I mean, they will, you know, be like 10 times more too, or more, 100 probably, but there's so many things, and the beauty also of this, you know, the from the tiniest little things. Now, when you put attention, you're looking sometimes for the big thing, and right in front of you, you have the most beautiful, incredible, tiny creature that's just looking at you. Thank you so much. And now we're gonna continue with my good friend Amos. It's an extremely well-known, amazing photographer who's been devoting his life. Amos, how did you get into photography? I mean, I would love to hear that, and please, the stage is yours. Welcome here.
First of all, good morning to everybody. And just that you know, I'm right now in Timor-Leste. And if you don't know where Timor-Leste is, go to Google Map and start searching, because the world is an amazing place.
Let me say, Amos, I'm so happy that you are there. Is the now that we know, there's a paper that shows that it's the highest concentration, highest diversity on coral reefs on Earth. Is the second newest country on Earth, by the way.
Perfect. Talking about the reef for a moment, I've dove here on the reef for the past 3 weeks, and I've never seen any place where the reef is in such a good condition, and the global warming or bleaching has not been arrived here yet. Hopefully not. However, before we continue, I just want to say that it is a very tough act to follow all these amazing friends of mine, friends of the ocean, from Joakim and from Christine and from Pierre and from Liz, from Alex, and of course, from Tanya. For me, hope is number one. And hope, that's what I wanted to, what I want to project most of the time through the photography. I am not a diver. I'm actually a photographer. Let's go back to one more aspect of life. In life, we as human beings communicating on three levels only: kinesthetic, auditory, and visual. Most of us, if not all of us, have only two of the three. That means that either one is auditory and visual, other kinesthetic and visual, or visual and auditory, or kinesthetic and auditory. But it happened to be that 90% or more of the population are visual and other kinesthetic and auditory. If you pay attention, that's why television and movie are so successful. So the medium of photography is probably one of the, is the most powerful element of conveying a message, telling a story, affecting many other people. For me, I was a photographer first. I did street photography or journalism in Israel. I did war photography. I was a fashion photographer. None of this element of photography really captured my imagination and my drive as a kinesthetic person and as a visual person. In the ocean, I find the challenge, I find the environment that allow me to express myself and to express hope, express discovery, express exploration, and able to bring knowledge or to share knowledge with others. The joy in my time of life and since my young life was to be able to share the experience with other people, see other people excel in their love or like of the environment, understanding the environment, and also in photography. In the first 10 years of my life, in my life in the ocean from 1978 to 1988, I mostly ran scuba diving trip to places around the world that was unknown at the time. Papua New Guinea, the Maldives, Madagascar, and of course the Red Sea, the home where I came from. During this time, see the destruction on the reef. Honestly, I got disenchanted. And after 10 years, I sold the company. And for 2 years, I took sabbatical from the ocean to find out what I want to do next. And then I learned, then I discovered the idea that, or reason from my experience, that people are afraid of the ocean. How to dispel the myth of dangerous wildlife. This is how I started the company or the business that, or the photography that aim to dispel the myth of dangerous wildlife and to bring more people into the environment, into the ocean. There are two ways what to do it. For me, it was either to go with picture and get them popular to magazine and have magazine publish them, hopefully, and pay enough for photographer for the work we do, which is very different than other photographer working on land or in studios. But also the other way was to be able to take people with me and lead them safely into the environment and bring them back home. And they tell the story from their own eyes about their experience in the wilderness. And that is where I created the company, the Big Animalist Expedition, taking people with me, have them participate, teach them photography. They become winner photographer in competition and make magazine stories. To summarize all of this in a picture, let's turn to the other picture that I placed in, the first one. Perhaps the epic in my story, in my life, was to be able to dispel the myth and diving with no other but the polar bear. In about 15 years ago, I had an experience diving with polar bear when I tried one of the first time, and the polar bear ran after me to about 75 feet. I was able to survive. And yes, I was scared to death, but that's the price you pay for exploration and taking the leap of faith into total new environment and new experience. But I believe that there is hope that I can deliver a better, in better situation. The reason that what happened to me then was as a result of technical difficulties of miscommunication among the crew that worked with me. The next time that we did, it was actually a movie production by the name Picture of His Life, if anybody wants to be able to see and to participate in the exploration and the effort that it took to reach this level of to be able to be. And as one of them, I think Alex said about being in the ocean and have patience and have a vision. And when a vision is created in the mind of a photographer, eventually by power that we don't know, or I don't know, Mother Nature provide. And we did the movie, and the idea was to take a picture of a polar bear underwater. And I was so lucky, perhaps, or luck is preparation, meet opportunity, that not one polar bear, not two, but mother and two cubs in total harmony, in total peaceful, was swimming over my head. Yes, it was a setup. We did not feed them. We prepared for the opportunity. I went out to deliver a message and to show to the world that it is not Jaws. Animals are not there to kill us. Animals are not there to gun after us. On the contrary, ocean is safe if we prepared ourselves and understand that we invade under animal territory, other world, and then to be more compassion and more understanding. What it takes to move to the next picture is to understand there is a say that all Chinese men said, vision without a mission is a nightmare. Mission without a vision is a daydream. So in my work, and throughout the work that I do, is to be able to bring images that are emotionally connect between us people to the animals, or the animal behavior that attracts us or the other people to appreciate what they see and hopefully falling in love with them. In this image, as you see here, it is the largest animal ever live on the planet. It is the blue whale. The mother was, in our measurement, about 22 meters. The young one was about 7 to 8 meters. It is the blue whale swimming along the coast of Timor-Leste right now, where I am right now. And there is a lot what to say about the migration and the hard time and the distance that the whale need to travel, but also about Timor-Leste and also about hope. There is hope, there is no hope spot yet here. And this time, and Sylvie hopefully listening to us, is the, my invitation to you, Sylvie, and to Mission Blue, to join me here next year and to be able to help these people and create hub spot also in Timor-Leste. Not just the reef is in excellent condition, but also to protect or to maintain the migration of the blue whale along this wonderful coast. Water temperature on 28 degrees Celsius, visibility of 80 to 100 foot, and it is a place that needs to be cherished. It needs help. There is a lot of pollution goes on, either from locally or other coming out from Indonesia. It needs a lot of support, direction, but this, with these images, either the polar bear or other the blue whale, to drive people to do more toward protection, or to encourage them to go to the ocean to feel safe, comfortable, and discover, as Pierre said, two worlds, or as Joakim said, the power of whales to protect our environment and to absorb all the carbon, most of the carbon dioxide.
Exactly. That's some of the things that we take for granted now from the ocean. It's you know, it's been making oxygen basically for a long time. More than 50% of the oxygen, so one on in two breath, actually comes from the ocean, no matter where you live. And that those things are so important. I wish we can all go with you, Amos, to the beautiful Timor-Leste. I've been once, and I really want to go back there. There's so much to do too. Those cool currents that comes deep from the you know, those channels, and then maintain some sort of temperature that is protecting also those processes, you know, that protects finally from these higher temperatures that is otherwise killing the coral reef in other places around the world. I think again, also, I love that you mentioned, you know, these pictures needs a lot of preparation. I know you and many other photographers who spend a lot of time on taking the pictures, not the shot, and that also, it's, you know, it's so related with the respect to the animals. But it's so important also, we know now that, you know, some of these places where we've been killing sharks to sell the fins that will, you know, otherwise the fishermen will sell it for a couple bucks, you know, I mean, maybe $20, best case scenario case, $100 maybe, they can be millions of dollars for tourism because the tourists can go and see them again and again and again and again, and they're doing their job. Whether we do it that in the right way or in the wrong way, I think it's important, and we need more discussion of that for sure. But definitely we have tools that we can use in better ways. So really appreciate that. I don't know how we are on time, if someone can help me how we are on time, but I'm gonna make basically one question to all of you guys, if you can respond quickly. I think it's a mix of many of these questions that have been put it here, and then we're gonna finish with my dear friend Sylvia. And or Sylvia, you let me know if you want to talk before I make this question. But I was thinking, you know, many people are asking, how do I get there? How do I get from, you know, being enthusiast to be a photographer or to be a storyteller? How do I can be one of them too? What would be your tip for them? And to add to that, to how photography can finally help us to save the planet, for science, for conservation measures, for action, you know, around this. You know, if you can then tell the people, what would be your tips to maybe some of them become also photographers, or also how we act, what do we do? What is that you're expecting, you know, to do? Because we don't wanna be just spectators of a destruction of the ocean. We wanna be the spectators of rebounding. I wanna be first, like front line of like, we did it. We did it big time. We saved the ocean, we saved the planet. And I'm not ready to tell my kids the other story, because we're not gonna let that happen. Please, maybe we start in the same way that we were talking, Christian. Yes, Sylvia.
How about if you let me just do a short thing with a couple of pictures while everyone is thinking about an answer to your provocative question? I am not a photographer, but I do take pictures. I use photography like a notebook to document what I see. And most of the pictures I take would never make the pages of the National Geographic, but this picture did. And it was just by chance. It was not with skill. It was not with a great camera. It was Nikonis with film. It was 1979, no digital, no flash, natural light. I was working with Al Giddings, Katie and Roger Payne, whale scientists. Our job was to observe and document for the first time, trying to get images of whales, humpback whales in Hawaii, singing underwater. This photograph was on our very first encounter with humpback whales. So it was not with a lot of experience. And Al Giddings, who wanted to be the photographer for all of the pictures, confiscated most of my camera gear. I was left with this one little Nikonis. And just everything lined up, I took this photograph, and much to Al's consternation, it appeared as a foldout, a really big deal in the pages of National Geographic. Here it is. And it's just an example of, yes, you should be prepared, and yes, you should get the best camera you can, but don't hesitate to take a picture when you have a chance. There it is. Triple truck, National Geographic. I'm not a photographer, I'm a scientist. And I love working with photographers because I can count on the likes of those who are being celebrated here today, sharing their stories, to really get the evidence, to get the images that tell stories. But for their skill and their capacity, their willingness to share their views, we would be far less capable of bringing about changes in the way people think. And it's still photography, but it's video, it's film, it's all of the means that we have to share the view, basically. Could I have the next image? Because it's another take on this, that all images have to be beautiful to move you. In fact, one of our friend of many of you, Wilcott Henry, has a habit of taking pictures of the good, the bad, and the ugly, to take pictures that tell stories that aren't necessarily beautiful, but they do touch your heart. like this picture in the Galapagos Islands, where you wouldn't expect to find a lot of trash, but you do. It's everywhere in the ocean. Well, in this case, this eel had set up housekeeping in the trash. It's a source, sort of a story about how nature tends to heal the harm that we have imposed. Look at all those things growing on this old tire. And to think that this eel had adapted it as a home where there wasn't much reef around. It was kind of a broad, flat area, but here was this handy little nest where the moray decided to hang out. And you'll notice his jaw looks a little wonky. I suspect he'd had a bad encounter with a human being somewhere along the line, but recovered. I love pictures that do tell stories. I look at this as a story picture. Now, I mean, every image can be a story picture, but some you don't need words for explanation. And I hope that's what this conveys. I remember a friend of many years ago who was a pioneer in documenting the little guys in the ocean, nudibranchs. He got to be so good at it that the Los Angeles Museum of Art, for the first time, featured photographs as art. This would be in the 1970s. And he was so excited because his mother was a great patron of the arts. And she looked at him as kind of foolish for going underwater and splashing around. And so this was his opportunity to look good in her eyes. Here was this beautiful display of these remarkable, colorful, magical little nudibranchs at the Museum of Art. And his mother did look impressed. At the end, she said, "You know, you must have a very good camera." I mean, huh, yes, it helps to have a good camera, but it's the person behind the camera who makes all the difference. And all of you, bravo. You bring talent, you bring vision, you bring stories. You're making a difference in a way that has advanced science, taking pictures that scientists don't see, or using images to extract knowledge, like the shark, determining that all those sharks are females. Who knew? Sometimes it's a backup, it's evidence. You might think that all those sharks that you saw were females, but thinking it so and having the proof that it was so are two very different things. So I am so pleased we're having this discussion, and you know, I think maybe we should do this again and have another opportunity to talk about some story images that we know have really changed the way people think or act. But right now I'd like to turn back over to you, Maximiliano, and the team, and hear your responses to his very thoughtful question.
Yeah, I mean, we're running out of time. I agree we should repeat this. And I would like also, you know, there's so many other photographers, local photographers in places, to inviting more of them to, maybe we should do a second round also inviting some other people. And because, I mean, it is so inspirational, no? I love, for those that don't know, but every time we go diving, Sylvia always carry a camera, and she actually takes great photos of people, of course, but also particularly like incredible things. And she have an incredible eye for finding things that I just don't know how she does it. I mean, like, she's like in the place, she can stay in like one square meter area, and she will take pictures all the dive. And I love that that you don't have to, like, you know, swim constantly, like, against the current here and there, like, sporty all the time. You can just be in this little space, and then you find the most incredible universe. There's a universe of nature, of life, and It's just, you know, we're so used to this. We want to see this like orca coming into your face or this or that. This is tiniest, most beautiful things. We just sometimes don't get it. Okay, I'm gonna go very fast because, as I said, we're late. So please tell us what, you know, a tip for the people that are looking at, which have been so grateful. I mean, so great on sharing, on being connecting and everything. And we invite everyone to follow Mission Blue on the web, on the Instagram, on Twitter, and following each of these people that are now here. And all of us, Sylvia have also an Instagram, and you can follow. It's crazy around the world, you know, going to all the meetings and meeting with incredible people. Anyway, I'm gonna go one by one. Christian, you are on mute. You still are on mute.
Okay. Can you please repeat the question? I was back to people.
I want to hear your tips for people who want to be a photographer and how to take action.
Yes. So, well, in my opinion, basically, the first of all, you know, it's really to be in love with the animals. But what does that mean? To be in love with another being is to care for them and to care for their happiness and their well-being, not ours. So everything that we do from there, it marks what we have to do. It's the basic, you know? And if we have that very clear in ourselves, everything we're gonna do, it's gonna be beneficial for the animals. Because if we don't start there, then everything we do probably is just gonna go in the wrong direction. Because even with the right intention, even trying to do something for the animals, it is not easy to find really a path that will actually benefit the animals. So I will start from there. And then, well, follow examples.
Thank you. Joakim, quickly.
Yeah, I'll try to be short here, but I agree with what Christian said. And also, if you have that passion inside your whole heart that you love the ocean and you want to make a difference, just go for it. Be inspired. Seek out people that inspires you. Look at photos that inspires you and try to, you know, if you're not already a good photographer, just do, if you're not, don't give up. I would say don't give up, because if you believe in what you're doing, you will reach the goal. Meantime, put up some achievable goal on the way to your main goal, and you will be good.
Thank you so much. Tanya.
So this isn't a very glamorous answer, but be very, very comfortable in the water. The water needs to be, being comfortable in the water needs to be second nature. Your buoyancy needs to be fine-tuned. I can hover within an inch of something just using the air in my lungs. And that is where you need to be to not hit coral or animals or other things like that. And if you're comfortable in the water, then that kind of rubs off on the animals you're around. If you're nervous, if you're making, you know, quick jerky movements, they pick up on that. They pick up on how you are feeling. So be very comfortable and competent and safe in the water before you ever think about picking up a camera. I think that's critical.
Thank you. Alex.
Okay, 3 points quickly. One, if you're going to go out there and shoot, whether it's underwater or topside, please don't try to take pictures for the likes. Take the pictures because you like them. Find something that you are passionate about to shoot. Yes, it's great to practice and photograph everything, but you're going to create the best images of the things that talk to you. So you need to make sure that you focus in on that. In terms of focusing in on things, if you want to make a difference, find local efforts that you can support. It's so easy to get bogged down in these global issues, but the global issues all stem from little local ones that transfer out into something larger. So focus on something that's close to you and close to your heart. Also, if you want to make the best images, gather as much information before you go as possible. If you're trying to create an image that tells a whole story, you need to know the story before you go. So as much information as you can gather about the place, the culture, the animal, where it's from, what it does, that's going to give you the best chance of creating an image that really tells a story. So that's where I'd start.
Thank you. Pierre.
Amazing. Completely agree with that. I would say trust the locals and tell a story. You know, when any doubt, trust your guide, your captain. It's likely that they're going to have way more firsthand experience in those specific waters and can be so invaluable in making sure that you have the best experience possible. And the most powerful images, they always tell some sort of story, right? So like Sylvia said, it's one thing to take pretty pictures, another to evoke a reaction from your audience and to make them feel, you know, whether it's empathy, awe, or horror. And these are all important feelings, and they can be used as catalysts for change or to inspire action towards social good. So having a good story can really elevate your work beyond the ordinary into the extraordinary.
Love it. Amos.
Well, that's the good thing to be in the end, because all what the people before me said it, I cannot repeat it again. And it is really outstanding collection of individual one by one. It is spectacular. And I will add only one more thing, if I may. There are over 7.5 billion people on the planet. Each one of us is unique. Go with unique in your heart and listen and learn from what Tanya said, what Alex said, what Joakim said, what Pierre said. The combination of all of it, that's what led you to be the next explorer, underwater photographer, educationer, and caring for the ocean. Love is the key.
And Sylvia, you want to finish this?
Well, a lot of the questions that have come in have been about what kind of camera to use. And I have to say, it's a little overwhelming because there's so many choices. Everything from packaging your cell phone to GoPros to little point and shoots to heavy gear. And most of the people who have been talking here have evolved into really sophisticated, sometimes kind of pricey camera housings for really good cameras. Having a great camera helps, but having a great heart and a great mind, a great perspective is even more important. So my advice for those of you who want to make underwater images, dive in and use what you've got and never look back. Keep improving your skills, get better equipment if you're frustrated, but you can really get great images by getting to know a place, getting to know the creatures, and making pictures. That's one of the advices across the board here, is to figure out in your mind, what is the picture? What is the image you want to share? And then with patience, waiting for the right light, waiting for the salamander to crawl in its little bed of seaweed or green stuff. You've got the image you want to capture. Or sometimes, like my picture of the whale, it's just dumb luck. But go for it.
Well, we are the lucky ones to having you, Sylvia, and to call us all for being today here together and having the opportunity to share with so many people that came to this webinar. I really thank you, everyone, from around the world. Sylvia, it was incredible. Before you joined, I think it was just from everywhere. I mean, I saw the places. It was, you know, Africa, Asia. It was, I don't know if there's someone from Antarctica there. Any penguin, please communicate with us. So anyway, thank you guys. Thank you everyone for this. Thank you to Mission Blue, people that have been working hard on this, Brett, Avra, and many others. Thank you so much for everything you've done. And please follow Mission Blue and follow these incredible photographers. Thank you so much.